morning. My name is Susan. Welcome to the Vineyard Church of Hoppington. We're so glad you came. Good morning. My name is Susan. Welcome to the Vineyard Church of Hoppington. We're so glad you're here. Hi, my name is Susan. Welcome to the Vineyard Church of Hoppington. We're so glad you came.
Well, thanks, Susan, and welcome. We're glad that you're here with us here today, taking this time to worship Jesus together as a church. My name's Stephen. I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm happy to be with you today. You know, this week has been a roller coaster, right? It's been up and down. It started out one way and then Wednesday changed everything. And today we want to acknowledge that and we want to process through that well as a church in a holistic way as much as possible. I think I, like you, was shocked on Wednesday afternoon when I saw the story start to unfold and I saw the videos and the pictures, and I was shocked that our country was so divided to this violent extreme. I was shocked that this was going on. And I was saddened as I saw the hate-filled actions that were unfolding in Washington, D.C. And friends, I wish I didn't need to say this, but because of the way that unfortunately some of this hate-filled stuff has been connected to the name of Jesus, I want to say that as a pastor, this in no way reflects the reality of who Jesus is and how Jesus calls us to live. Jesus has asked us to love even our enemies. That's how extreme he wants us to go. Now, I don't think I actually have an enemy, a human enemy, who I would say kind of hates me in that way or that I hate in that sort of way to put them in that category. But if I did, my response as a follower of Jesus is not to take action against them. It's to love them. That's what Jesus tells us to do. In 1 Corinthians 13, Jesus lays out for us a path of what love looks like. Listen to what Paul tells us here about Jesus's way of loving. He says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. And it does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures in every circumstance. So as we begin, I want to pray for this sort of a love to be our reality and the reality that we see reflected in our world. Let's pray. Jesus, we just ask for you right now to help us as your followers to love others well. Forgive us for not being kind and patient. Forgive us for being proud and rude, for demanding our own way. Forgive us for being more focused on getting what it is that we want than on seeing injustices righted in our world. In every circumstance, and especially today, we ask for your love to be the thing that helps us to endure, the thing that we reflect to our world, the thing that guides us above and beyond every other thing in our life. Jesus, we love you, and we ask that you will help us to love others in a way that is worthy of being connected to your name. Let us love others in a way that reflects you to our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Rob, our lead pastor, is going to share with us today. He's going to talk about why it's important that we're connected into a church. But before he comes, I asked a couple of people who are in our church what it is that they love about small groups, because you see, small groups are starting. They're starting up this week and next week. And so we would love for you to get involved. But before I say any more, let's see what they have to say. Thanks for joining us.
Well, we have small groups starting for January, which is always an exciting time in our life at Vineyard Hoppington. We love small groups, and not just because we're spending more time at our homes by ourselves right now, but because we just like being with each other and growing closer to Jesus in that way. And when I was thinking about people who love small groups in our church, two people popped to my mind fairly quickly, and that's Susan Little and John Gargan. You guys love small groups. And so I thought, let's just ask them why they like small groups. So with that, Susan, why do you like small groups?
when I first came to the church, there was a lot of people, and I would get to know them on Sundays, but not personally. Like, I wouldn't hear all their stories. So when I started doing the small groups, it was wonderful because you got to hear people's stories, how they were during the day. We would get to pray for them or pray for me, you know, whoever needed it. And it was just a togetherness that I never really had, where, you know, just totally accepted and loved for who you are, and everybody's welcome. And that's been a stronghold for me to stay connected to the people in the church and to do different groups to get to know different people. Zoom during COVID, I'm here by myself all the time, and I did work, but it was so nice. I had 3 weekly groups. I had Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday nights that I sat down with people that I knew, and we got to talk, and I got to learn, and it was fantastic.
Small groups, one of my favorite topics. My first experience was I really became a believer through a small group. I was in England and with a mixture of British and Americans, and, you know, coming in off the street, kind of, I just saw something. I saw a love and a friendship and a bonding, and the Holy Spirit was there. And I'll never forget my first impression of that home group. It just kept drawing me back. And, you know, eventually through the home group, through hearing the Bible and through the friendships and the fellowship and the love, I eventually, you know, gave my life to Christ through that. Right now, because of COVID, it's especially important because we have that basic need to love and be loved, but also to belong. Mm-hmm. And belonging to a home group, oh, it makes you thrive because you can get down to knowing people in a deeper way. And, you know, in church, a lot of times we meet people and we have some top-level discussion, but you really get to know people in a deep, deep way at home groups, and you can really bond. And we really need to bond with each other, especially during this time, because, boy, it really encourages us. So I'm a promoter. I'm on board for home groups, and I hope you will be too.
That's awesome. Well, thanks, guys. And everybody else, go to our website, click on the small groups tab, check out the groups that we have, sign up for 1, 2, or 7. And you don't even have to sign up. Just contact a leader to find out a little bit more. We'd love to have you join. That's why we start and stop. So there's always space for new people to jump in and be a part of our small groups. So we're excited to do life together this winter. Thanks.
And yet what we see in the Bible is a much different picture of what the local church is meant to be. Like, the local church is meant to be a place where men and women are sanctified as they know one another, that God is at work in the mess of the Church of Jesus Christ in a given location. And so the Bible's going to call us towards one another and towards commitment to one another, not in just some kind of universal sense, but really in a localized sense, that I am to be known, you are to be known, that our weaknesses should be seen and our strengths should be seen. And so I want to encourage you, when you think about church, when you think about the gathering, when you think about that community of faith that you're going to, I want you to not just go to, but belong to it, be a part of it, give your gifts over for its betterment, receive from it, not just all the things that you prefer, but receive from it even the things that will be difficult. The local church has always been messy. Go and read 1st and 2nd Corinthians if you just need a primer on this. The church will be messy. There's a lot of sinners involved, but the messiness of it should not deter us from the primary method by which the Spirit of the living God sanctifies us and grows us more into the image of Jesus Christ.
Good morning, church. Really great to be with you again. We record this on Thursday, and yesterday, Wednesday, in our capital was really just a very disturbing, distressing scene. No doubt by the time this is aired, by the time you're listening to me, much news is going to be recorded and much analysis would be made. But this is what I'm reading in the newspaper this morning. Wednesday, which is typically a routine procedure in the presidential transition, descended into one of the darkest days of for American democracy, Congress's procedure to certify the election results in favor of Joe Biden was halted when a mob of President Trump's supporters infiltrated the U.S. Capitol building shortly before Trump held a rally in which he repeated lies that were that he had won the last presidential election. The result has been that four people apparently have died as the Capitol was overrun and two pipe bombs were recovered. Friends, this is disturbing on just so many different levels, but particularly disturbing for me for the way that politics and Christianity have become interlinked in very, very unhealthy ways. I just keep saying, what is our Christian response to this? And surely we need to be convicted to pray for our country, to pray for our democracy, to pray for unity in our country. I mean, Jesus wants us to love our neighbors, and our neighbors have become people in church which have different political views, people in our country which have different political views. But even if it's our enemies, I mean, if we're starting to see our friends or our fellow citizens as our enemies, we need to be praying for them. We need to love our enemies. And so I just ask us to really have, a heart of compassion for those that are our fellow American citizens. And love is going to win this out. We have to tone down the rhetoric. Our words carry weight. Friends, join me praying for this country, praying for our friends, praying for our fellow citizens. Well, let me ask maybe a different question. Why do you come to church? Or why are you listening online today? What is the reason that you're listening? Or maybe more pointedly, how do you decide how often you are going to attend church? Do you make that decision based on a commitment? This is what you do, it's a lifestyle. Or is it based on, if it's convenient? Or does it happen that you come to church when there's a crisis and you need God to intervene in your life? Or how do you decide how regularly you attend church? And then maybe I could even ask, well, what is church? Is church small group? Is church this experience, Sunday morning experience? Is church a combination of both small group and in-person attendance or online attendance? What is church when I say attend church? And again, I want to make a plug that going to church is attending a big group gathering and attending a small group gathering, because there's something different that happens when we all get together, and there's something else that happens when we can be in small groups and we all have a chance to interact and talk and express our thoughts and our feelings and be prayed for individually. So I really suggest that we do both. Today I want to open in prayer as we jump into this idea of, can you be a Christian and not regularly attend church? I want to open up with really praying Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God. I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Lord Jesus, I just pray these verses. Lord, I just pray that they would hit our hearts. Lord, I pray that you'd allow me to be able to expound on them and to preach your will. In your name, Jesus. Well, I obviously could do a whole sermon on these really powerful verses, which I'm not going to, but I do want to point out a few of these thoughts here. I plead with you to give your bodies to God, and I plead with you to consider regularly attending church. It's a way of giving your bodies, giving your ability to allow God to do something great in your life. But you have to make yourself available. And it's a form of saying thank you back to Jesus. It says, let them be living sacrifices, the kinds he will find acceptable. I mean, part of attending church and doing small groups together is saying, God, I'm trying to give back to you. I'm trying to express my thanks to what you've done, which is absolutely incredible in my life. But again, when we look at verse 2, don't copy the behaviors and the customs of this world. The big idea here is that we let God transform us into becoming a new person. It's not our own struggle. It's not our own work that does it. We allow God to transform us. Our responsibility is to show up. Can we show up? Can we have our minds attentive? Can we listen? And we can say, God, go at it. Transform me. Shape me. Change me into who you want me to be. Because if we allow God to do that, our lives will be exciting. They will be rewarding. They will be full. And they'll be meaningful. And so I want to look at that today, is how do we live our lives? And part of living our lives is being part of Christian community, being part of God's plan and living in it. Have you ever had a lawnmower and accidentally put two-stroke gasoline into the lawnmower? Maybe it's just me. But let me tell you, the lawnmower still goes. It works. But man, there's blue smoke coming out everywhere. The thing's running unevenly, and it just doesn't work properly. I mean, you know there's something not right, even though it's still working. And I feel for many Christians, that's their life. Yes, they've become saved. Yes, they've asked Jesus into their life. But they're not walking it out. They're not living the way God has designed us as believers to live, which is partially attending church regularly and attending small group regularly. In other words, it's being molded by our community, but it's not just any community. It's a faith community. It's God's institution. It's God's community. It's God's plan. And it's been God's plan right throughout the Old Testament and into the New Testament. Let's camp out a little bit in Hebrews chapter 10. And I want to just press this idea of being once committed to the Lord or saved once versus this ongoing transformation where God makes us into something holy. Look what it says here in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 11. Under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which never takes away sins. I mean, honestly, it sounds boring. It sounds very religious. It sounds so routine, and it doesn't work. I mean, it's really sad. And then we've got verse 12. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for our sins, good for all time. Man, it is never bad news. It never gets old when we say, come to Jesus, receive Jesus, accept Jesus. It never gets old. It's the starting point for transformation. It's a major turning point when people will say, yes, I want to cooperate with God and I want God first. And realizing that God is bridging this gap for us so that we can connect to the Father, that we can become His children, that we can become saved, that we can become followers of Jesus. But it's the becoming. It's only the starting point. It's a vital starting point. And if you haven't received Christ, I'd encourage you right now, ask Jesus into your life. You've got to experience the love of the Father and the forgiveness. It is the starting point, but it's not the end point. And I think so many people don't attend church regularly because they misunderstand this. It says this, reading on verse 12, "Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand," talking about Jesus. "There he waits until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. For by that one offering, he forever made perfect those who are being made holy." Onward, progressive being made. Yeah, we do have to enter in, and we have to actually enjoy it. It's like we have to go on vacation. We can't just talk about it. We can't just, have the means to do it. We have to actually commit and do it and go on vacation to enjoy the benefits of vacation. Jesus promises a rich and rewarding life, and we need to experience that. But look what it says here in verse 22. "Let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him." I mean, here's an ongoing, continual thing where we enter into the presence of God, where we say, "God, we need to be in your presence again and again and again for you to do what only you can do, and which is to bless us, to transform us, to change us." So let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him. And then in verse 23, it says, "Let us hold tightly without wavering from the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep His promise." See, the problem isn't on God's end. The problem with the rich and rewarding life is on our end. Will we do what we need to do? God wants to bless us. He wants to provide for us. He wants to show us. But He also wants us to show up and to cooperate with His Spirit and to cooperate, quite honestly, with other believers. Look what it says in verse 24. "Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works." Man, a complete contrast to what we saw on TV on Wednesday night in the Capitol. How can we motivate each other to acts of love and good works? And I think when we gather together in church or in small group, part of what we're doing is we're hearing each other's stories and we're thinking of how can we motivate each other? How can we help each other? How can we encourage each other to do the things that God wants us to do, the loving things? And then verse 25, "And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another." And we take that very lightly. We do forget to get together and to meet together and to make that a commitment to do so. And I would encourage us to constantly want to get together. Now, I understand that online we lose some facet of what we gain in person. Corporate worship is more challenging. And even more challenging than that is actually experiencing the Holy Spirit collectively. There is a dynamic that when we gather together, we are encouraged how other people are worshiping and entering in, and it draws us in, which we can't do as fully when we don't gather together. But part of our heart, there should be a hunger in us that we want to experience the fullness of gathering together. And again, it comes in different ways, small group and big group. It's not either or. I think it's both and, because each of it we gain something different from each aspect. It reminds me of a joke I heard recently. There was a church that was meeting in a veterans hall, and around about Veterans Day, they decked up the hall a little bit, and there was a plaque there with American flags that were put around for the veterans who had died in service. And one of the kids came along to the pastor and they said, "Why are there so many flags around this thing? What is that?" And the pastor said, "Well, it's a plaque for those that died in service." To which the kid said, "I'm not coming to in-person service anymore. I'm sticking to online. I don't want to die in service." Yeah, okay. But there are very specific benefits spiritually that happen when we come to church, which honestly we can't really control. I was reading a great story about Charles Spurgeon, one of the just giants in church history, just recent, you know, he was a dynamic preacher in England and used by God really, really powerfully. And this one particular, it was a Wednesday night service that he was doing, he got a word from the Lord about a certain person sitting in the audience. And he did something which would be very, let's say, politically incorrect, or maybe we should say not acceptable in church circles to do. And that was this. He pointed at a man and he said, "You, young man, are a shoemaker, and you did not come to church on Sunday. In fact, you sold your soul to the devil for £4. That's all that you did on Sunday. You sold one pair of shoes." And then he moved on and he carried on preaching. So somebody obviously was concerned, went up to this guy. I think he followed up with him during the week, and he said, "Wow, what happened?" And the guy said, "Well, actually, it was very helpful." He said, "I felt very embarrassed. I was singled out. I assumed that the preacher knew me because he had come into my shop and knew that I was working on Sundays. But then I realized, how would he have known that I only sold one pair of shoes and that I made £4 of profit? So I immediately gave my life to the Lord, and I've changed all my ways. I am not going to open my shoe shop on Sundays. I am going to commit to going to church regularly." Wow. Don't you love it when the Holy Spirit works in that way? And that is actually what we've experienced in our church. We've seen God do dramatic things. And the only thing is we can't control it. We can't manufacture it. We can't make it happen like every Sunday. But we also can't know when God is going to work. And I've seen it again and again. Those that attend church regularly don't miss out on the blessing. They're just days where God just seems to work in your own life personally in dramatic ways. I do want to talk about commitment, as I have been, and I want us to think about, you know, the idea that God changes us as we commit. Think about the disciples of Jesus. They weren't exactly friends before they got together, but they made a commitment to follow Jesus. And they became friends. I mean, you know, a tax collector hanging out with fishermen, not so much. But they became friends. And even though, you know, there were times when Jesus was talking to them and they were bored and they didn't get it, and they, you know, the thoughts were elsewhere, Jesus is like preaching something really serious with them and they thinking about like who's going to be the greatest. You know, by hanging out with Jesus, they became friends and God did something in them. In fact, pretty dramatically, God changed the world through average people. And he's doing that in our lives and in your lives. And part of it is committing to becoming a disciple of Jesus, just regularly going. Look what it says in Ephesians. It says this, Christ loved the church. So there's a parallel here. Christ loves you and Christ loves the church. He gave up his life for her. He gave up his life for you and he gave up his life for her, the church. Jesus did this to present her, the church, to himself as a glorious church without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. God looks at you and he forgives your sin and he says, you are perfect. You're without fault. And yet, obviously, there's two things going on here. God is looking at our future with him, and he's also looking at us presently and saying, you are not perfect. This church is not perfect. I'm not perfect. I mean, you know that. But God is saying, this is the organization, the means, the establishment that he makes people holy. He uses imperfect people like me and others to get together, mold each other, and become who God wants us to become. It happens individually and it happens corporately. Commitment-based relationships produce long-term meaningful relationships. A commitment-based relationship to church, a commitment-based relationship to marriage, a commitment-based relationship to a sports team. If you're going to have long-term benefit, you want to make a commitment to that relationship. There's a parallel with churches and marriage. A long-term relationship based in Christ, molded by his love, going through the ups and the downs is what God wants it to be. But I want to also just hit this idea that Jesus did not come to make Christians. He did not come to make converts. He came to make disciples. And there's just so much more to being a disciple. It's being a convert as a starting point, but becoming a disciple. And the reason is that God has a plan. He has a plan for your individual life, but your individual life's plan is part of God's big plan. And that's where the magic happens, is when God is using you for the purposes of God and it all fits together. Let me explain it this way. N.T. Wright, who's a popular theologian currently in England, Episcopal theologian, he said this: the covenant Jesus makes with us is vocational. God's purpose is not simple relationship with us, not only living with us in community, but to accomplish the mission God has for the church, for our community, starting with what he has started through Abraham. Genesis 12:3, all the families on earth will be blessed through you. And God is still in this process of using the church to bless you and to bless people through you and to bless the nations through us. Again, you know, we are to be a people that are blessed and that people want to get the blessing that we got. They see what we got and they want to be blessed the way we are, which again is why it's so disturbing when what we're projecting to the rest of the world on our Capitol Hill with the violence and the looting and the rioting, it's like this is not what we want to project. We want to project a country that is blessed by God and other people want to receive the blessing we've received. We want our church to be a place that people say, hey, there's a blessing there and we want to receive the blessing. And that's what God wants for us. You know, Jesus said, the passion for God's house will consume me. And what he meant there in context was he was passionate about the temple because he was passionate about what he was going to be starting, the church. And he was consumed by that. He wanted church, the temple, to function the way it should be functioned, where we as people are connected to God, where we can be inspired, we can receive his love. And in doing that, we can also give gratitude to God. We can thank God, we can worship God and praise God, but we can also then be vehicles that are blessing to others. That's what Jesus was instituting. And he then describes us and describes church as living stones. Look the way he says in 2 Corinthians 6:16, "For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, we will live in them and walk among them. I will live in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they will be my people." We are going to be living stones. God will live in us. But we are stones that are part of a building. One is depending on the other. We are not stones in a field just in isolation. It works when we are together. And so God wants us to be a community where we are connected to each other, not just, you know, an isolated individual. Our living stones are because we help each other, we support each other. If you want to make a declaration that you want to be a follower of Jesus, that you're grateful for what he's doing, I encourage you to just commit to doing church and small groups regularly. You will become friends. You will start developing relationships. You will start experiencing God's love. You will start being used by God. Your life will start having meaning. Your life will start becoming full. Friends, I just leave it to you. Make a commitment this year to regularly be part of church weekly and put God first. Bless you.
Pass the Lord, so pass the Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, yes, I will sing of the goodness of God all my life. Oh, all my life you have been faithful.
Just take some time and pray. I want to pray for a couple of things Rob mentioned to us, to pray for unity, to pray for the church and our witness as followers of Jesus in our country, to pray for our country as a whole, and to pray for the unholy mix of Christian and nationalism to be broken over the church in America. Christian nationalism is not a thing of Jesus. It is not Jesus's plan. It's a thing that the enemy has done a good job of sneaking in, though. We want to pray for it to be broken over the church. This week, we want to pray for God to arise, to be at work, and we want to just acknowledge our own sinfulness and our own need for forgiveness for the ways that we haven't done what it is that Jesus has asked us to do. And as our guide for this, I want to pray the Lord's Prayer. So I ask you just to come and to pray here with me right now. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, you are holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And right now, Jesus, I just pause and give us space to be able to repent from our own sins. We don't point fingers at others without acknowledging the reality in ourselves that we have sinned, that we haven't lived up to the things that you have asked us to live up to. Sins that we have gone along with, things that we at the very least haven't spoken up against that have brought dishonor to your name. We repent for that. We repent of sins of trying to attach your name, Jesus, to things that don't get attached to you, that have allowed monstrosities like Christian nationalism to pop up and to grow because we've gotten so confused in where our allegiance needs to be first as followers of Jesus, that it's to you in your kingdom alone. We ask for unity in our country, Jesus. Heal divisions. Speak against the plans of the enemy to divide us, to bring people violence and anger and hatred towards each other. We ask for protection from the plans of the enemy in our world. We repent for letting our own desire for power affect how we treat others in our lives, Jesus. The pride, anger, bitterness, selfishness that we've allowed to rule in our hearts, we repent of right now. And we just say, your kingdom come, Lord Jesus. We say that we reject the temptation to let our political affiliation rule, to let that be king in our lives. We want you to be king. We want your kingdom to come. Lord, I thank you that our church is filled with people from all different political leanings, Republican, Democrat, Independent, and that in that we don't see division because our unity is found in you, not in our political party, because you are king. And I pray that that will always be so. We as a church just pray again and continue to pray for deliverance from the enemy's plans for hatred in our world. Come, Holy Spirit, bring your love and your peace to our country in Jesus' name. And we just end by saying the last words of this prayer. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hi friends, Happy New Year, Happy Late Christmas. We did a very special Christmas Eve service collaborating with Community Covenant Church right down the street from us. They were wonderful to work with. Together we did a very special Christmas nativity that kind of walked through the story of God's coming to be with us and invited us to come to Jesus. Community Covenant was just great to work with. We had about 300 folks come out to our Christmas Eve service. Thank you so much.
Mary has said yes to the coming of God in her life. As we experience the meaning of Christmas, will you say yes to the love of God?
His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace.
Thanks for joining us today. We're really happy that you came, you worshiped with us, that you spent time here. And our prayer for you is that you encounter the love of Jesus. His love brings peace. His love brings patience. His love brings relief from the anxieties and the stress of this world. I pray that His love will be your truth today. And I want to invite you right now to go on Zoom and to join us. I'll be there. We're just giving some space to hang out, chat with your friends, get some prayer if you want it, and also to talk about small groups. They're starting this week and next, and we want to give you space to ask any questions you have about how to join a small group or what groups we have going on. So click that button on the chat, join us on Zoom, and we'll see you next time.